Okay, so let's give this another shot here. What are we going to do? We're going to create a morphable dolphin, and there are three steps to do that. And then we're going to use this example right here, the Savage Biologics dolphin model. If we go there, we'll also find that there's one other model, and that is the predecessor of this in the dolphin, and we've renamed this to be unknown dolphin model. And somebody gave us this example some time ago, and the trouble is we're not sure who actually authored it, because they got it off the web and there were no credits, and so we're still looking. So I'll put out a plea here. If you do know who the creator is, or if you're the creator, please holler so we can give you credit for this wonderful model. So it did inspire the work you're about to see, although this is a different model. Okay, so the model we did here was performed by Chris Lang last summer. Chris first went through a couple-week course learning how to author in Maya, a high-end tool, and I believe that was a game programming course up at Stanford University. He took a summer course. And then came by, and this was last year actually, that he did this and worked through a high resolution dolphin model that he constructed in Maya. And then we not only exported the body, the geometry to X3D, but also the behaviors. So here's how we do it. Here's step one and of the three. And so first we create the baseline geometry. And so what he did was use Maya and export to X3D. Actually, I think he probably exported to VRML, and then we imported it into X3D using X3D Edit. There is a tool for use with the Maya called Raw Key that you can also use for converting and exporting models. Let's add that. Let's add that to the slides right now. And that tool is by Aaron Bergstrom. It is an open source tool. Where would you find it? Well, as with most things, we go to the X3D resources page and locate that thing. Okay, so X3D resources, and then I believe that's on conversions. And sure enough, here it is, right here under conversions. Project Rocky, open source X3D plugin for Maya. And here's the page for it. Okay. So, a lot of cool stuff there, and that is open source. It is on sourceforge.net, so anybody who happens to have a copy of Maya can also use this tool. Okay, so what did we do then once we got the first version of this out? He created alternate poses, and he made sure, exactly sure, that he used the precise same number of coordinate points that made up that body. And we looked at those, and then we checked them with a switch node. Okay, so let's see how was that set of steps performed. And we'll do that by going out into X3D Edit again, and we'll look at our dolphin poses. So here's dolphin pose number one, and we can see that this is a flat and level dolphin. Nice detailing very carefully constructed, smooth model. If I shift to wireframe mode, we can get a sense for just how complicated it is. Very sophisticated model. Okay, now if we look at the second pose that Chris did, we can see that, it looks like it has the same geometry, but the tail is flipped up this time. Okay, there's pose one, there's pose two. And if we go to pose three, we see once again, same shape, same underlying geometry, and the tail is flipped down. Okay, so given that we have those three, and if we look at the models themselves, you can see they're quite simple. We just have a material and then an index face set that lists all the coordinates. For fun here, we'll bring one of those up and see what they look like. Here's the coordinate node, and we can just see how many points are there. Well, let's go down the bottom. Index 507 starts at 0. Okay, so we've got 508 points. If we go up to the parent node, the coordinate node. If we now go up to the parent, which is the index face set node, then there are our coordinate indices. And I guess this might be time for a feature. Maybe we should put in min and max checks. So please add that to the minutes for today, Ken. That would be a useful authoring feature. What we can't do is count the number of indices. That wouldn't matter because, if you recall, the coordinate indices indicate whether or not or how big are each triangle. So we can see here that we're getting a pattern repeated over and over. We'll get three index points and a minus one. Here we have four index points and a minus one. Three index points and a minus one. Three and a minus one. Four and a minus one. Three and a minus one. Okay, so either triangles or quads. And this is very much up to the modeling software that you start with. So what the checks would do is we would like to make sure that these are only legal values, and the range would be the allowed range would be from negative one, since that's a sentinel, zero is where it starts, and it would go up to n minus one inclusive. Okay, so that would be a helpful check for the tool to add. Most browsers will holler at you if you use illegal values in there. They'll give you an error, which is what it is. Okay, given that we have those three different poses then, let's go ahead and look at our switcher node. The switcher node is interesting. We can see that we have a switch, and then we have three inlines. One, two, three. You can also see that we put in a couple of groups here. Those groups might seem superfluous. I guess they are. They're extra. But we did use them for documenting. And this is a good case of, instead of putting comments in, we just use the def name to describe what is it that follows. Okay? So you don't always have to use a comment. Sometimes you can use def. All right? And there's a reminder in here that our switch goes from 0, 1, 0, and 1, and 2. And then we have the integer sequencer node, which we learn about in Chapter 9, Event Utilities, that's just going to pump out these values, 0, 1, 2, then back to 1, then back to 0. Okay, and so let's look at this example. Okay, so we can see our scene now flipping between the three things. I'll shift it to wireframe. I am not steering this scene, but rather it is animating on its own. Let's try the wireframe now. There we go. Okay. So at this point, it's much easier than before to see that, yes, we did preserve the connectivity. Chris was very careful to keep the same triangles in there and just mush them around to new positions. So depending on your authoring tool, that can range from difficult to challenging to well-nigh impossible. When you get good at it, it's not so bad. And at that point, you're ready to get the big bucks, get paid the big bucks as a Hollywood animator in the 3D animation studio. Here we are showing that it is quite possible. Okay, now that we have this, let's run all the way to the finish line and say, well, once we can switch, what would it look like if we morph? Okay, now in the morph, we go, oh, okay, that's pretty. Very smooth motion. Let's shift to wireframe. Alt shift W. And we can see, boy, it's quite fluid the way the coordinates are varied. Even though we know for a fact there's only three poses in there, but those three subarrays are each getting interpolated from one to the other and then back again. Okay, so if we were going to do this in our coordinate interpolator, then one way we might do it is we would have pose 0, all of those coordinate values, and then pose 1, and then back to, let me rephrase that. I think that's 1, 2, 3 is how we did it. And I better stop and check here for a second to make sure I get this just right. Yeah, okay, here we are. So the poses. Zero, 2 is up, 0, 1 is level, and 0, 3 is down. Okay, but then we want to repeat, correct? So to repeat it, to get a full cycle, we're going to add two more in here. We're going to go from down back to level. And instead of starting in the up position, we'll start at the level. Okay, so what am I saying here? Our interpolator is interpolating between each of those five poses, one to the other. Okay, well, that sounds good, but there's still another twist in the knickers here, and that is, that's a lot of points. No, that's an awful lot of points. We saw that when we opened up one of the editors and checked it. So how could we reduce some of that repetition in here? Because we do have an index face set, and notice in the comments that it says we start with neutral pose 01, And so that's, all of those coordinates should be just the same. But then we have our coordinate interpolator, and let's count up how many points. We'll start again at the coordinate. This is our neutral pose. So we had 508 positions. Now let's look at our coordinate interpolator and see how many positions we have in there. Okay, so we have three poses instead of five, and it goes all the way out to 508. Okay, so 0 to 507, that makes sense, and a variation of 3. So what the next part of this example is going to show you then is how could we go from 0 to 1.5 to 0.5 to 1 and then back up from 1 to 0.5 to 0. Okay, if we could cycle like this, then we don't have to have so many points in a row. Having all those points as a row, how we usually do a coordinate interpolator, but just the act of cutting and pasting these things just gets so humongous that we decided, let's get a little more clever. So we did. While we're here, we could also look at the interface for coordinate interpolator. Notice we have set it up as a table to make it easy for you to work with this, and we can add each of the lists, each of the rows, or subtract them. We can add columns if we need to add another point, etc. So we've tried to facilitate it, but in an example this big, the best we can do probably is just cut and paste so far. Maybe someday we'll have a fancier editor, but this worked, so we're good for that. So the next part is, how did we trick it into doing going up and going down? And the answer lies in this scalar interpolator, where we put our up and down sequence in here. So we started in the middle, and we went down to level. Excuse me, we went from level to down to level to up to level, flat. Okay, so our scalar interpolator is doing some intermediate filtering here. So let's look at how that was accomplished. Okay, here's the documenting slides for what we just looked at in the scene, and of course, there's a lot of due diligence here when you work in such a big model that you're carefully cutting and pasting exactly the right number of values and not dropping any, because otherwise it completely goes out the window. Here's our switcher, where our switch has each of these guys that it switches among. Here are our poses labeled for us. And then we put those in the coordinate array. And the first time we did it, we actually did put all five in, not just three, but five. And then we said, oh, we've got to be able to eliminate these two. And that's what our next section is now going to show. Okay, so when we do it with all five, of course we need four intervals with five breakpoints between them. Okay, so we could see that there's four transitions there, five different stops, and the beginning and the end, index 0 and index 1 are the same. So that's why we loop. But that's with 5. So how can we go through 3? So if we want to get from 5 to 3, there's a non-trivial reduction in points, some 40%. So let's continue down this road. And we said, okay, so all we had to do was delete two of the rows in here and reset our key values to match, okay, this factor right here. And now what we're going to do is intercept the value going into key. Instead of having it just be a ramp function 0 to 1, we're going to have it ramp up and down. Okay, here it is spelled out. So if we draw the first case that we did, it was like this. Keep doing that. My goodness. Here's the first curve. But in our second curve, what we're going to do is we want to change it to a different characteristic. Instead of a sawtooth, we want it to be a triangle ramp like this. And that way we're cycling through the three positions rather than the five. In other words, we're going backwards in the downslope. We're going backwards through the interpolation and driving the interpolator in reverse when the inputs are on a negative ramp. Okay, so here it is drawn out even a little bit better. Each of these functions are repeating, obviously, because loop equals true. And then we can see by this little handy-dandy event graph, animation chain that we have here, that what we've done from the usual of clock, interpolator, target, let's label that clock, interpolator, target, we've modified our usual pattern to put a pre-filter interpolator to massage, to modify, to condition the time sensor clock output. Okay, and therefore we do get to do the both forward and backwards. The forward is the upslope and the backwards is the downslope in here. Okay, so that's how we put it together, and that's how we reduced it by 40%, or 2/5 smaller than what it might have been otherwise. Here's a screen snapshot of the scene, and there's the full explanation. Finally, you have our tooltips for coordinate interpolator. Okay, so that describes our most sophisticated example. Once again, welcome to the mountaintop. We've gotten to the real peak of capability here. We'll look at a few more interpolators and sequencers, but the themes remain the same. The way these are hooked up are the same. The value of routing and having all of these primitives, strong data types, ways to convert from one to the other, means we can create the effects we want. Okay, so that completes our examples for Chapter 7, Event Utilities. Excuse me, Chapter 7, Event Animation, Event Animation Interpolation. Next chapter is Chapter 8, User Interaction. We'll pick up again there. Okay, so finishing up on touch sensor, we do have an example here in the book, touch sensor pump house. Let's look at that in X3D Edit. Here we go, touch sensor pump house. And if we look at our touch sensor description, we can see, yes, indeed, we do have a description there on that touch sensor. And it says touch to activate. Okay, well, that should be a good enough user cue. And we click on that, I point over it and then select it. When I deselect it, it stops. When I move the mouse over it, you see the mouse changing. When I select it, it starts moving and animating. With some browsers, you might see the cursor change yet again each time you do that. Again, the cursor icons are up to each browser. What do they want to show? But here we are. When I let go, it stops. And then, interestingly, when I start it by selecting it again, we'll see it jump just a little bit. Well, in that case, it didn't. Oh, okay, good. Maybe we fixed this one. Originally, the example had, we were setting start time and stop time on this guy. Let's see, that's all the rocker arm assembly. Let's find the routes for the touch sensor. Here's our touch sensor. We'll search for the route. There it is. Okay, so instead of driving it by start times and stop times, we send our isActive selection to the clock, whether it's enabled or not. So we picked a Boolean instead of a time value on this, and that way when we click on the pump, we get, looks like we're getting a smooth animation. Where am I fooling myself? No, it does look like it's jumping a little bit. Let's get it all the way down. Yep, it is jumping. Okay. So, for a second there, I thought maybe we were going to resume time, pause and resume time, but no, we're turning it on and off. Now, the reason why it jumps a little bit, let go, click, there it clearly jumped up, is the nature of the output of the sawtooth wave from the clock. And that sawtooth wave is defined by, we recall from the definition of the terms for time sensor, it's defined by the computer clock. Okay? So that's not how long did I wait, that's not when did I start, it's the exact time of the clock. So if we first select here and go to there, then when I re-click it, select it a second time there, you can see that we had to transition from one to the other, and there's a discontinuity, a jump. So this is why, if you're using start time, stop time, or if you're using enabled, you can get this little jerkiness, jumping effect, and it's a little bit random. It even fooled me to start with here. If you want to get things going smoothly so they would always go, then we could change this scene to instead use pause time and resume time. As a way to control the clock. And that would mean instead of using a Boolean is active, we'd have to use touch time on the touch sensor to go to those guys. Now the reason we didn't do that is because we'd have to get further logic involved there, because as we recall, touch time has three different occasions when you may or may not get a value. First, when you go is over, and second, when you go is active, when you select it. And third, you also get a touch time if is active false, you deselect it while you're still touching. Okay, So to keep this example fairly straightforward, we left it where we just used the booleans, because that way we knew whether it was moving or not. And then by clicking on it, by selecting it, I'm just starting it up. And frankly, those little jerky pieces are often not noticeable by people. If you want to get fancier than that, well, we'll show you some tricks about that someday. Okay, so the next example in touch sensor is opening some doors. Everybody likes to open doors. What's in here? Well, let's see. We don't have to necessarily be literal when we build different pieces of the world. If we are building little tiny light switches and carefully articulated rotating doorknobs, well, you have to say, not only am I matching the functionality in the real world precisely, but I would have to make sure the user can carefully do that and that it's big enough for them to do it. Ordinarily, light switches and doorknobs are much smaller than they need to be, than we might use in 3D. Why? Because we have hands to reach out and grab them. Our hands have much finer motor control than the ability to move a mouse around and point and select, click and drag. That can be very hard while people are navigating and do multiple things. So does it have to be that hard? No. Could it be just as complicated? Sure, if you want, but we don't have to. So this is where it's nice to be liberal rather than literal. So it might just be that if the user selects the doorknob, that's the same as them telling you, I want to open the door. And you don't have to worry about fully changing it. So we use this example to not only illustrate how to do that, but also to compare the difference between initial selection and then deselection, when you either click or when you unclick. Okay? Now in each case, there's an isActive event being sent. In the first place, in the selection, it's true. When the deselection is false. So we're going to take advantage of some of these nodes right here, Boolean filter and time trigger. These are some more of the event utility nodes we'll see in chapter 9, and this lets us put things together a little better. So here's the scene graph for our example. In Chapter 8, User Interactivity, the doors example. And if we follow the logic here, we can see that there are two touch sensors. There's touch left, and there's touch right. Okay, and when we do that, there's a corresponding timer that drives it. So in the timer right, we can see that we just had a very simple touch sensor, time sensor, and then orientation interpolator, these three nodes right in a row, and the output from that sequence goes up to the right door. Okay, that's our classic animation chain. What did we do a little bit differently in the left-hand door? Well, we used a Boolean filter to, first of all, get rid of the one we don't want, and instead filter on the one we do want. And then we used a time trigger node to convert that Boolean value from a true false to a time value. Okay, so let's pull this guy up now and take a look at it. Here is the left-hand side. Make sure I get it right here. Where's my touch sensor? Left-hand door, appearance, index. Here's our right-hand touch sensor. There's our left-hand touch sensor right there. Okay, so now we're in the left-hand door, and Okay, and if we look at the time sensor, that's pretty unremarkable. We don't want it to loop. We want it to start at zero. We want it to have a 3 second cycle. It's turned on. If we look at the time trigger, you can see, boy, there's not a lot to that node, just the name of it. And all it does is take a trigger left. It takes a time, let's check that route out, in fact. Trigger left is going to output a time and start a timer. That means trigger left is going to get input a Boolean. Okay, so just as we said, it's getting a Boolean in, and that Boolean's coming from our filter, which said if the input was true, and only in that case will we pass along the true value. So we can see from our Boolean filter node that this is, in fact, you don't see any values here because there aren't any settings. When we learn about this in the chapter 9, we'll find what are the fields for that guy. We can confirm them right here by simply going to the node and reading them. So here's our touch sensor that says, if I'm active, which is a Boolean, then connect up to the Boolean filter and its field, Boolean input. So this gets it started. So if we want to see all the nodes for input on the filter, we can see them right here. And obviously there's just one to choose. The other route tells us what might we change on the other one. And here's our filter left, and it has several outputs, whether the input was false, whether the input was true, the one we use, and then input negate, flipping the value around. Okay, sneak preview of future nodes, but same themes, you know, connect up, get the types you want. To be careful, follow the 10-step process until you get adept at just hooking these bad boys up. Wow, a lot of explanation. What does it look like? Well, let's check it out. Here are the two doors. If we click on the right, well, I'll say out loud when I hit the selection, and then we'll watch the behavior. So my mouse is over it on the right, select, nothing happens. Deselect, here the door comes open. If I select, nothing happens. If I deselect, it repeats the animation. And notice how, in this case, the door slams shut instantly and then reopens again, because that's what our orientation interpolator was doing. If you wanted to have a closing behavior, you'd either have to wire up further logic or say, well, when my door opens, it'll come open and then stay open for 5 or maybe 10 seconds and then shut by itself. And that's one way to get that done with just a single construct like we have here. We go, wait a minute, only opening on deselect isn't what we want. Usually what we want is the user, by selecting, indicates do it. So let's try the left-hand door. Select, and we see it opens right away. When I deselect, it sits still. Again, select, deselect. Notice I didn't have to hold on to it that time. It kept going until the finish, because the true event is the only one passed through. That true event kicks off the animation from its beginning. That's how we wired it up. If we wanted to make it where it was pausing and resuming and only opening, for example, while you had the mouse down, then we could have routed to pause time and resume time, or done some other tricks like that. So really, it's pretty much a matter of your imagination on how best to hook these guys up. Okay, what's left? Well, there are the tool tips for touch sensor, how to put them together. All right, now we get to look at our mouse pointer-oriented nodes, also known as drag sensor nodes, because they not only let us select things, but they let us move the pointing device while selected, drag it around, and change it. And what we'll see is what we expected to find out before is that how do we convert that 2D pointing device motion, up, down, left, right, how do we convert that into a value? And in this case, it's connected to a three tuple SFX3F, in other words, a position. And how did we get from a two tuple value over here from the mouse and three tuple? Well, easy, we made an assumption and we said Z equals zero. Whatever the local coordinate system where that plane is flat, we're gonna add that zero value, and so all we have to do is pass the value. So this is actually a pretty simple node, simple to understand, simple to use, and we can just plug it in there. The rest of the words in here just match what we always expect from a sensor. Sensors affect their peers or their peers' children. Sensors themselves are not visibly drawn when we render the scene graph, when we look at the scene. Simply, they're an activity that's there. And then, given that we have this three tuple SFX3F, that's typically a translation value, and we route it where we want. So we might go to a parent transform, and there's a mistake right there. It doesn't go to the rotation, but rather it goes to the translation, of course. And if you don't like the translation, then fine, send it to another field elsewhere in the scene graph. Okay, what other fields and events exist here? Well, as before, we have isActive. And that's pretty helpful because we can use that. We have minimum and max position. That lets us constrain how far can the user go with their pointing device. If it's off to the wild blue yonder, then they may be interacting in a way that you don't want and your scene is going places that are just too far. So sometimes we'll give it min and max values so we can home in for it. Just how far do we want that thing to move? If you're, say, opening and shutting a sliding window, then you would want to constrain that in the downward direction only, and probably not even any left or right, because you wouldn't want it to jitter. Similarly, for a sliding door, you might give it min and max left and right, and the same value min and max for the vertical, so it didn't have any direction to go there. Okay. The example we give here is a simple box. Notice that the box gives you the opposite corners. So here we have a square box that's units of 4 meters on a side. Okay, then the next fields are a little bit tricky, but not too bad. Offset and auto offset means offset is the value that you're getting. When you slide around your sensor, your plane sensor, wherever you end up inside there, inside that box, that's going to be your offset value. That's the result for that. And then auto offset says, do I remember that or not? Do I reset to the initial position or do I pick up from where they last left off? Sometimes you want to reset. Okay, each time you open the door, you might want that to be, okay, it's a door that fully opens and then closed by itself. Or you might want auto offset to go the other way. If you want the window to remember that it was halfway down, then we'd set auto offset to true so that when the pointing device came back later to select this thing, it didn't jump to an initial position, but rather started there and then let you push it back up or down to where you want. Okay, if all of that control isn't quite enough for you, if you want even more, then there are two other fields here. Translation changed and track point changed, and those match the other sensors for just where was I in that thing when I selected it? Okay, so here's an example. And plane sensor pump house. We can see what the fields look like on this. We've got a min and max defined, and also an initial offset value. And we've set auto offset equal true. Oopsie daisy, let's try that again. We've set the min and max. We get an initial offset, and we set auto offset to be responsive like that. Okay, so let's try it out. X3D edit. Whoa, we got some extra stuff there. Plane sensor pump house. Here it is. Now this is a funky little scene. Here's the part right here. This red bar is what's changing, what is activated. And I'm seeing the mouse icon change when I put it over there. So if I click to select the bar, then I can slide it up and down like this. And this is modifying the displacement a little bit. So we can see that it goes a little faster or a little slower, change it around. Again, it's kind of a funky, it's not quite a direct cause and effect. I usually like a cleaner example than this. We probably should try something like not have the pump move at all and just have this push it up. And instead of it being a position control, it's more of a rate control. In any case, you can study the guys here and see how we push those values around. Okay, so that's plane sensor. Not a lot to it. There are other examples. The Vermal source book is a good place for that. And you probably want to try some yourself. What's next? Well, this one's a little more sophisticated. Cylinder sensor node. And the way it works is it converts our XY motion from the sensor into a rotation. And the way it does that is of course, if you're going to go from 2 degrees to 6 degrees, that's all about what do you constrain. Before, we were producing a three tuple, so that means we constrain Z to zero. Here, we're creating a four tuple, an SF rotation. So what do we do to constrain that? We say the Y axis is fixed, and then our XY motion gets translated into a cylindrical rotation about that y-axis. So when we drag on something, it assumes that the y is unchanging, and any drags we do on the surface of that produce an equivalent rotation value for how might it modify about that axis. Okay, so pretty clever, pretty simple mapping once you got it. And when you look at the rest of the node here, you see, oh, same as before. We only affect our peers and their children, and we get a rotation as an output, so we can change it to a rotation field in the transform, or we can do something else with it if we want. We can send it elsewhere in the scene graph. Okay, here's a close-up of how that looks, and we've taken this figure from the book. And by the way, it is worth looking at the notes in this chapter. We've got a lot of notes for plane sensor, a lot of notes under the slide for cylinder sensor that help elaborate what's going on. Of course, you can read the book too to get more detail. So let's decipher this diagram. Given that we have some geometry, which may or may not be a cylinder, it might be that we've got actually some kind of rectangular box here in the center, or a cone or something else that we're grabbing. So the geometry shown could be anything, but the behavior shown is going to pretend as if it were a cylinder. So First up, our cylinder sensor Y-axis stays constant. Every drag, every selection, click and drag we do here is interpreted as a rotation about that axis. Then the way to measure this is, given that we go in and click on a point, like right there, track point one, if we click on that and then rotate to drag to right there, then this gets interpreted as we start with the initial rotation there, the final rotation there, and then we've got a little math elaborated here that tells you how it works. Now, there is, because it is a cylinder sensor, there are two ways to interpret this. And one is that you're on the sides of the cylinder. The other is that you're on the top of the cylinder. So how do we know whether the selection was dragging on the sides or dragging on the top of that? Well, there is the parameter in red called disc angle. And disc angle is something that you set as an author that says, where do I transition from, am I on the sides right here, or actually am I on the top and dragging it in this kind of a circular motion instead of this kind of a circular motion? All right, so if disc angle gets bigger, so we could say that if disc angle gets bigger like that, it means there's more sides, it has more side motion. If disc angle gets smaller, then it's more of an end cap type of rotation. Okay, so that's a little bit of fine control you have as an author over the precise behavior of this thing. If you have actual geometry, then that's a good thing to line it up with. So the mouse dragging on this invisible virtual cylinder is actually right there. And so here's the underlying math. Boy, that can make your head hurt thinking too hard about it. So this is mainly for explanation. The best thing to do is test this guy and run it. We'll test that shortly. Let's see what else is in here. We've got a couple of events that we're quite familiar with. We've got is active. We've also got min and max angle, similar to the min and max we had for x and y before. The min and max angle would let you constrain the rotation. Maybe you don't want a 2 pi radian 360 degree rotation. Maybe instead we only want a 45 degree or a 90 degree rotation as the max available. You can probably think of plenty of cases in the real world where that is the case. Other parameters, offset, auto offset, exactly the same. How do we put an initial position in there? How do we remember what the value was when the user lets go? Do we snap back to the original, or do we stick from where we remembered each time there's a new one? And then finally, we can track what was our rotation and also the actual point where this occurred. Okay, now let's look at the example. And make sure I get the right one here. Okay, cylinder sensor pump house. When I select this red pointer and rotate it, you can see the pump house start to move and then move back. And in fact, this is pretty twitchy, so I just moved it right off the screen on that one. Usually it's better behaved than this. Let's see if I can improve this. Well, sorry, I should have retested this. Let's try it in another tool. Okay, now see, when I drag it up, the pointer went up. Now we, well, this isn't working so well. Let's try a different browser. Yeah, this is a very awkward example. We should probably improve it a little bit. When I drag it up, we can see that the pointer has moved from horizontal, where it was over there, to up, where it is here. And then when I go down, it's going to rotate the other way. And what's happening is, okay, I can change, I can rotate it to the right and then back again. What's happening is there's apparent rotation right about here in the center of the scene. And so this guy is rotating about that center and back again, and that rotation is slaved to the rotation of this guy right here. So we can use it as sort of a remote control. This example points up a good design issue that usually when you have a remote control changing something, it's wise to move the remote control to be separate from the change so your controller stays in one place. So a good improvement to this scene would be to take that controller and put it right on the side like this, so that as the user changes it from one position to the other, we just see the intended geometry move and not everything move. The other way to fix this would be put the viewpoint so that it's getting moved too, and it moves with it, and your controller stays in the right place. Okay, so let's see what's left here then on cylinder sensor. We have another important thing to look at, and that is if you start using cylinder sensor a lot, it can get a little frustrating that it's always the Y axis, it's always the vertical. So what would you do if you want to go off the Y axis? What if we want to rotate about the X axis or the Z axis or some arbitrary axis? Well, there is a scene graph pattern to do that. You can't do it just with a cylinder sensor node. We never gave it a field for what the axis is. Should we? Perhaps some people would argue that we should. So I would call this a possible spec enhancement or improvement in the future. And will that happen? I don't know. That's up to the X3D working group. But you don't have it today, so how do you get about to do that? Well, the answer is you have to put in your own rotations, but you have to be careful, because if you just rotate your sensor and all of the geometry, well, now your sensor's the right way, but your geometry's the wrong way. So the idea here is you have to have a pattern that first rotates sensor and geometry, but then rotates and restores the geometry to where it originally was, so that when we rotate, it'll be about the new axis and not everything just cockamamie and messed up. So it is a little tricky. Here's an example of how you might do that. If you didn't want to rotate just in the Y axis, you would put in a parent transform first, that gets you moved, and then we added a visualization technique here of putting in a transparent cylinder to help you see where the rotation is. This is of course optional, but important when you're debugging or developing to see just what's going on. And then here's our if this was our first rotation to get the axis that you want, then here's our restoration rotation to return the geometry to its original orientation. Okay, so it's a two-step process, And this shows you how to do it, with the key being highlighted in blue here. Where did my sensor go? Okay, so we can see that this sensor is subject to the first rotation, but it's not subject to the second rotation. The geometry is subject both to the first rotation and then the identical reverse translation that brings it back again. Fairly simple, once you get it. Fairly maddening, if not. So rather than reinvent this pattern, I recommend you just steal it and use it. Okay, and there's our pump house example with case one and case two for how it works. And there is cylinder sensor. Now, it's a little out of order, but I want to point out to you that at the end of this chapter, we've got a section called additional resources, and we've listed a number of prototypes or extension nodes in here that also work. And so that design pattern of moving the cylinder sensor axis has been common enough that we created a prototype that simplifies it. And so it works basically the same with two minor exceptions. It lets you define the axis you want to rotate to, and then you have to put the children you want to rotate, not as peers, but as children, instead of peers with a regular sensor. It has to be children so that this prototype can work on them. Okay, so if we look at the example, we can have a picture here of what it looks like. And on the top, we have not one, but actually five different rotations. The first axis is like that, second axis is like that, the third axis is coming out of the screen in the Z direction here. Here we have an off axis, and there's actually a invisible axis here that we can rotate the text around. So the second picture shows this guy rotated about the Z axis, this guy rotated about the Y axis, this guy rotated about, you guessed it, the X axis, and this guy rotated about an oblique, and this guy rotated about another oblique. Let's look at it. Oh yeah, I've got this zombie vividity in here. Let's try again. Oh, I gotta call it up again. Thought I had it. Okay, so it's in Savage. Under the Tools and Animations directory. Okay, Tools, Animation. And here they are, arbitrary axis cylinder sensor examples. We'll launch it in instant reality and take a look. Open this guy up. So here's the first one, click, drag. I can go left and right, it doesn't matter so much. If I go up and down is when it has a real effect. And so that's rotating about the x-axis. This one's rotating about the Y. Notice that I didn't turn on that cylinder every time. There's a Boolean for that. So this is something the prototype gives you for free if you want it. Either putting a central axis or a horizontal spinner bar on there. And then finally, if I can select the text, I can rotate it as well. Notice that similar to the green cube, it doesn't have any axes shown. So pretty handy dandy little prototype that can help you deal with your scenes. Okay, one more drag sensor. And that's our sphere sensor node. What does sphere sensor do? Well, very similar to cylinder sensor, except that instead of constraining the y-axis, we constrain to be a rotation about the origin of the local coordinate frame. So that's equivalent to saying fixed radius, meaning that when you click on the geometry, it treats it as if you, that point, it computes its radius to the local origin and say, okay, I am now going to hold that fixed. So anywhere you move your pointing device, up, down, left, right, it's going to rotate about that, compute a rotation as if that initial click distance was fixed, and then it will follow you around your mouse so that, in effect, you get a spherical rotation. Once again, it's the same as before. As with all the other scenes, we get to route that SF rotation value to a transform's rotation field, or we can route it somewhere else if we want. What fields does it have support in addition to that? Well, pretty much all the old favorites here. And is active, offset, auto offset. If we want to keep track of things even further, we can get rotation values directly from rotation changed. We can also get track point changed. So this is maybe worth noting, that what's the difference between offset or rotation changed? Well, you'd use this one for continuous. You'd probably use this one for final. How good are the browsers at observing that? I don't know. We'd have to check. Here's our example. And what we did was we put a sphere in that has the sphere sensor interactivity associated with it. And its description is simply, well, drag me to rotate lefty. So let's try that out. Okay. Back to Out of Savage and back into chapter 8 of the book, and Sphere Sensor Lefty, and howdy Lefty, how you doing? He's just swimming away still there. When I move my selection device, my mouse in this case, over the sphere, click and drag it, meaning select and rotate, it moves. As soon as I let go, it doesn't move anymore. Let's try that again. Select, and notice how I can even select off of the device, and it appears to keep moving a little bit. Then it stops, quits moving. Okay, so that's how we affect it. Clearly, my 2D. X, left, right, up, down mouse motion is going all the way to a 3D rotation in any direction. Okay, so using a sphere itself as the interaction device for your sphere sensor is probably a good idea, because then the user gets the feeling as if he's rotating the ball. And if you wanted to emphasize that further, you could map a little texture on there and let the ball itself also rotate as you rotate whatever the target was, and you could see that visual feedback instead of just imagining that the ball is rolling. So if we want to see an example of that, let's take a look at our user interactivity sensor nodes. This is sort of our mother of all sensor node scenes, where this is collecting all of the examples in this chapter. So if I click on, let's get this guy out of the way so it's not blinking. Okay. So if I click on the touch sensor, we've got that routed to, you guessed it, background. So it's binding a different background node. Select, deselect. Select, deselect. If I click on the second one, the plane sensor example, and then drag, then my cube will start sliding around in that axis. If I click on the third one, cylinder sensor, I'm able to rotate it left and right. I'm not able to rotate it in the vertical direction. If I get my sphere, I can see I can rotate that in any direction here. Okay, so if we look at that scene in detail, you can find each of those sensors and each of those nodes. All right, what's left? Well, there's actually two more sensors, and those are our keyboard sensors. Let's try those out. If I hit the keyboard right now, and you can see the one key changing as I do that. And then if I stop and hit the enter key, then there's that string that I typed appearing right there. So let's try it again. I'll type in hello X3D exclamation point, enter, and there it is. So we similarly have keyboard input, either a key at a time, which might be good if you want to drive things or rotate things or make a user interface for a Twitch game or something like that, or you can type in full strings to enter that kind of data. Now let's see how this was put together. Key sensor, okay, key means one at a time from the keyboard, and give you a few choices here of what you might do it. Besides interface, it might also be a menu where the user's presented, say, with some text or even a texture telling them what to do, and they hit the right key for the choice. Notice that X3D does give you control of the Control, Alt, and Shift keys. And so if you want to process these, because it is a little bit involved, we do make you route them into a script node, and we'll learn in Chapter 9 just what are the tricks then for making that work. The events it has are pretty similar. Is active, of course, means you're typing. Is active means you're not. So that could be helpful if you want to distinguish between the press down of the key and the release of the key. If you want to put a time delay in there or let the user, you know, cue on which one, then you could pick, do I cue on the true event or the false event? Key press and key release give the string values for them. Again, you get to distinguish whether it's the downstroke or the upstroke that you're paying attention to. And then we also have an enabled field, but it's curious that the key sensor does not have a description field. Maybe because where would you put it? Given that you have a visual display and the key sensor is active, well, it's not associated with any particular geometry. Is that a good choice? I'm not sure. Maybe we would want a key sensor somewhere or description somewhere to tell you what's going on. Perhaps in the border of the scene. The reason we didn't still on that is sometimes scene displays don't have borders. They're just a big cave or something like that. Okay, we also have special keys that we keep track of. We don't call them special keys, we call them action key. Once again, we can distinguish between the pressing and the releasing of the key, so you can route the event that you want from that key sensor node. And you can see the values that it might give here, depending on the special function key, the action key that gets pressed. Okay, and here's an example of the key sensor in the a variation of the lefty scene, where we say press N for next viewpoint, P for previous viewpoint. And here's some actual script code that we used inside a script node to deal with these kinds of things. Okay, I won't belabor that, but rather let's rattle right on ahead to the string sensor node. What else is in there? Well, we saw it. We saw it demonstrated a moment ago. It appears to have no effect until you hit enter, and then it gives you a final text is the field that is the output. But notice there's a difference here. You can also, instead of taking final text, you can do the entered text. If for some reason you care about deletes and backspaces and other things, any corrections the user might have made. So do you want a final result or do you want to parse an intermediate result? We give you the choice of both. And we even let you turn on or off the ability to control deletion through the deletion allowed. Okay. Once again, we have is active and enabled, but we do not have a description field because it's not always clear where you might put it. So let's look at this example. It's called string sensor.x3d. You can see that the interface is pretty simple. It just has the two fields that are settable. Like most sensors, this node is all about outputs, so that's why we don't see it in the interface for the node. But we'll pull it up and test it out. No, not you. No, not you. Yes, you. String sensor.x3d. Okay, I'm going to start typing now. H-E-L-L-O, X3D, exclamation, exclamation, enter. Blah, where'd it go? Maybe I didn't have it selected. Let's try again. No joy. I thought this guy worked in XJ3D. Okay, so we can see that instant reality supports it, although it doesn't have spell checking, and it ignored me when I tried to backspace and correct. Let's check out our string sensor. It says deletion allowed. So should it have allowed me? Yes, it should have hidden that. But maybe we're not sending the right value to there. What did we do? We routed the entered text. So if instead of the entered text we wanted to take the edited text, then we'd switch that to final text. Okay, save. And then when I go back out to instant reality and reload it, now instead of, and I'm not sure what I hit to turn on the, statistics, I must have hit some hotkey there. So now we'll try it again. H-E backspace E-L-L-O space X3D. Turn off this, statistic. It's not telling us what the hotkey is, so I'm not sure what's doing it. And then enter. And what happened? Okay, so not fully working. Partly working. We could try, well, let's try once more. See what Octaga can do with this scene. Hello, X3D. Okay, now we'll type it again. Hello, number 2. All right, and then I'll type no, no, no. Bunch of backspaces. Yes. Okay, so at least one out of the three is fully functional. And today, Octaga won the challenge, the string sensor challenge. All right, so let's revert this scene so that everybody gets the default, and so that I don't clobber it during the next update. So I will revert the changes I made. And we'll go back to the slides. And one thing I don't put in the slides is which browser worked and which didn't, because that's a moving target, changing over time, and I don't want to slam anybody inaccurately if it starts working. Okay, there was the converter script we used, and finally tooltips. Okay, so what's left? Final home stretch. We have a description now of the scene that we checked, the user interactivity sensor nodes. That's the scene right here, and here's the description of it, which we've seen throughout this. What can we do on each? We have three drag sensor nodes. And in fact, maybe we should get a little more precise. We could say select and drag to rotate a cylinder sensor cylinder, and we're going to select and drag to spin a sphere sensor, and this, in this case, these are together, sphere sensor working with a sphere, cylinder sensor working with a cylinder, and plane sensor working with a box. And here we'll just say on the screen. And there you go. The next slide is helpful in that it shows you the default up top and then the modified on the bottom. Since everything is modified all at once here, you can tell that I rotated, I dragged, I typed in a key, I typed in a string, and then finally, what came last? The touch sensor was last. Why? Because it's binding to the viewpoint, and as soon as I let go, the background would, it's bound to the background. So as soon as we let go, the background would revert to that color. Okay, so this scene is also an excellent test of a browser if you want to make sure that all the sensors, all of the primary sensors, are working at once. And here's a copy of that scene, a few different ways, highlighting the nodes that matter, and how we used them. Okay, so chapter summary. User interactivity, very key. This is what makes 3D fundamentally different than other media, than 2D pictures, than video. The ability to get in there and change things, move things around, respond to the user. It's more than just animation, as important as animation is. It's also the sense of presence that people get where they're in charge, when they are able to move a scene around and make it react the way that they want. Suddenly the 3D-ness of it, the perspective of it, the changing view, the immersion goes way high, and you can have a greater, much greater sense of engagement, somebody in the 3D and in thinking of it not as, oh, I'm clicking on a computer screen, but rather they're in that 3D space and interacting with it. Okay, here are suggested exercises for this guy. Once again, I can't overemphasize the 10-step program and routing, drawing the routes on top of that on the pretty print. I don't by any means suggest you keep doing that for the rest of your career as a 3D animator working with X3D, but rather do it enough times so that you get it. And then you got it, and you can use it to make things work. And then guess what? When something's not working the way you want, and no matter what you do to debug it, it doesn't seem to happen, that's the time to break it out again. When the going gets tough, the tough get verbose. And printing that out, drawing those lines, lets you go, oh yeah, I expected to do this, but upon an inspection, I find that I missed something. Okay, we have a number of additional resources I've added to this chapter that are pretty cool. Cool because a lot of these were written by students in this class in early iterations, either the beginning or more likely the advanced class in X3D. So arbitrary axis cylinder sensor, we saw this before. This is one of the cool ones. Here's some others. We have something quite like a time sensor, but it's a time delay sensor, meaning when you trigger it, it has a time delay before it starts. And if we look inside this construct, we see, first of all, that it is a prototype. Prototypes are new nodes that we can define out of other nodes. And it looks something like this. It looks like a time sensor with a cycle interval equal to the delay. So once you first click on that, this clock has to time out, and then that triggers a second time sensor, which then behaves normally. Okay, so our prototype just put those two things together. Pretty neat. Here's another one, time sensor in-out display. The way this works is, instead of doing a simple sawtooth like that for the time sensor output, which, if you recall, was called fraction. Instead of doing that, it has a lower slope, and then a higher slope, and then a lower slope before it goes down. So as a result, we get this sort of sluggish response at first, and then a little bit faster than it would have been, and then slower response at the end. All the other parameters are exactly the same. And if you look at this guy, well, I haven't looked at it quite recently, but I think we'll find that we have a time sensor drawing a scalar interpolator using a similar trick to what we did in modifying a time sensor in the dolphin example. And then that drives a second time sensor. So again, we're filtering, we're massaging, we're modifying the inputs to this time sensor so that it looks a little different on its output, and it turns out to be a handy dandy animation trick. Okay, no, I didn't want that. Okay, then what's another one? Double click touch sensor. Well, this is a handy thing because we can replace a touch sensor with it, and it sets a delay interval, and this will only trigger if you get two clicks at once. Okay, and if those clicks are longer apart than max delay interval, then it does not fire. It says, oh, those were two single clicks rather than a double click. Okay, do we give you a double click, a double select feature in X3D? No. Do we let you extend it? Yes. Should we maybe call this a double select instead of a double click, since we usually talk about selection or click? Well, I guess we could. To be more precise, maybe we should, but everybody says double click, so that's what we call it. What other coolness do we have? Well, that's about it. We have the usual references, spec, authoring tools. Thermal Sourcebook has lots of great examples. Definitely you want to go there and check those out. But if you get into advanced techniques and you want to look at that, most of the work that's been written up on advanced techniques is not documented in X3D. It's documented for programmers or for animators. So we have a few references here that help. John Barilou's book is wonderful, 3D User Interfaces in Java 3D. And because Java 3D Scene Graph has so many similarities to X3D, I think it's a rich treasure trove of techniques that we'd eventually hope to incorporate. In fact, for advanced students, I think taking examples in there, writing them out in X3D is a fantastic exercise, and that we'd want to keep adding those to our results. Then, here's the main book on 3D user interfaces by Doug Bowman and a few other big names in the 3D world. And not only is the book fantastic, but there's lots of examples and design patterns and user studies. They put a high premium on not saying, well, this is good because we think it's good, but they actually conduct user studies and test whether or not things work the way they expected and improve it or refine it or redefine it if people's actual perception of the user interface is different than actuality. And finally, Bill Sherman, lead author on the next one, Understanding VR. There's a lot of VR books out there. This is a very thorough one covering the breadth of the field. These folks are well engaged and key players, as are the others. So don't let me fool you. The Vermal book is usable almost exactly as X3D, because Vermal is the direct predecessor. But this is a book about programming. It's probably the closest to X3D because Java 3D scene graph is similar. These books are both about programming. So if you're not a programmer, don't bother to go there, except maybe to look at the pictures or get a feel for what the techniques are. But if you are a programmer and you can think both ways, X3D scene graph and programming, you can get a lot of good ideas for what your script nodes might be, what your techniques might be. To learn more about these techniques, the two primary conferences are SIGGRAPH, which, as we mentioned earlier, does include interactive techniques, right up there with computer graphics. But we've got to mention SIGCHI as well, because that's where user studies, techniques, where a lot of this work is done. And then there are two other conferences here, 3D Symposium, 3D User Interfaces, also the annual VR conference. And now that I think of it, I should have added it before. I'll add it to the list now, WIST, UIST, User Interface, I think Science and Technology. We'll add that link, is another key reference. Okay, so what do we have here? User interactivity, we've got end-to-end, tons of stuff. There's still a few more nodes, but I think you have enough now to really make your scenes quite interactive, and I hope you have fun doing that.